Alexis Goldstein here. I'll be doing an honor this Friday the 2nd of April at 11 a.m. EST. A little bit about me, I currently work advocating for a safer and fairer economy. But I started my career on Wall Street. I worked as a programmer at Morgan Stanley in electronic trading, and as a business analyst at Merrill Lynch and Deutsche Bank in equity derivatives. I recently testified before the House Financial Services Committee in their second hearing about GameStop. You can find my written testimony here. I also discussed the GameStop situation on Twitch with AOC back in February. Here is a clip of our discussion.
And there's one other wrinkle to all of this that I think is important for folks to know, which is a lot of folks have used the app Robinhood, which I like to think of as the Facebook of stock trading. And I say that because Facebook is sort of designed to keep you on Facebook, right? It's designed to grab your attention and keep your attention. And Robinhood is very similar. I would describe it as gamified. I know a lot of Robinhood folks would disagree with that assessment. That's just my personal assessment. But Robinhood is free. It doesn't charge commission. And the way that their business model works is they sell their order flow to market makers, which are these sophisticated Wall Street participants who execute the orders for them. The market maker they sell the most of their flow to is a hedge fund named Citadel. And Citadel is not just a hedge fund. They're also a market maker. They're also a technology company. They're owned by a billionaire named Ken Griffin, who is out of Chicago, who has funded some very questionable things in his political giving. But Citadel pays for Robinhood's order flow. And strangely enough, or maybe not so strangely, one of the hedge funds that Wall Street Bets was very excited about blowing up, Malvern Capital, was rescued by Citadel after it blew up. So Citadel is paying for the order flow on Robinhood, which is driving up the price of the stock, which crashed one hedge fund, and then Citadel sort of bought that hedge fund on the cheap after it crashed.
Hi everyone, thanks for coming today.
Is this the armor, or will there be a dedicated new post?
I was going to use this one.
Sorry if it was asked before, what languages do you prefer to use? Linux, Windows, or Mac when moon laughing face, asterisk.
Do you mean programming languages? If so, I'm partial to Python. You can do so much, with so little code. Linux or Mac. But, if I need to crunch things in Excel, it's nice to have access to a Windows machine.
Hi Alexis, this is going to be a bizarre question, but how did you pave your place in your career whilst being a female? Your job career is extremely inspiring, but I've always found people say it's difficult to break ground and really forge a career for yourself in that sector. I wish you all the best in your career and thank you for giving your time.
There's certainly a lot of deep-seated, structural attitudes that create hurdles for women in finance and outside of finance. And even out in the world, just to give one example, some people will comment on women's appearances instead of on the substance of what they say. Hopefully we can all work together to change this. The best generic advice I can give is, work hard, don't give up, and look for mentors who can share what they've learned.
Hi Ms. Goldstein, I think I speak for everyone when I say we're incredibly grateful for your time and perspective on any questions raised within this sub. I thought I'd get my post out early to give a chance for you to potentially review them before the armor. Before I ask my questions, and on a personal note, I just wanted to thank you for when you interjected to offer an alternative perspective on whether Citadel posed a systemic risk to the market in the second hearing. I believe this led to the most important discussion of the entire hearing, which as we all now know resulted in Mr. Kelleher's statement later being scrubbed out of the video by CNBC. Please feel free to ignore any question should it put you in any kind of hot water or for time purposes, and please also correct any point if I'm wrong, but with that said, please see below some questions I think this board is interested in related to your expertise. One, I note you previously worked for large institutions in relation to risk management software, among other things. Can I please ask how is it possible these systems allowed a firm like Melvin, who presumably had them, to lose billions in January? 2. Do you think institutions utilizing dark pool and OTC trading, especially in relation to GME and retail buying, results in an unfair ability for entities such as Citadel, who execute the majority of retail trades, to manipulate the lit market price by essentially removing legitimate retail buying pressure from the lit market by routing such purchases in dark pool OTC markets? 3. You mentioned in your testimony that position data and stop losses, etc. are likely being mined, collected by institutions. Can you please elaborate on the extent and types of data mining these firms may use so retail investors can protect themselves where possible on public message boards? 4. If you had the sudden ability to change the laws to create a fairer and transparent market, what steps do you think would be the most efficient to achieve this, even if only short term? 5. What kind of impact to the lit market do you think would occur if Citadel and other entities of similar stature were declared as a systemically important financial institutions? 6. Citadel and other firms in a similar role have a very checkered past in relation to fines and enforcement, in your opinion. How likely is it firms such as this are engaging in conduct of a similar type for GME? 7. In your opinion, how likely is it that the DTCC's net settlement and stock borrow program is being abused to falsely represent failure to deliver obligations? If you get a chance to answer any of these, I'd be grateful.
There are a lot of questions here, so I'm just going to start with one for now. For in the short term, a lot of changes that can happen with the laws we have now, through actions by the regulators. The SEC should consider changing reporting requirements on the Form 13F to bring about more transparency. Here's a recent letter I helped to write on the topic. The Financial Stability Oversight Council is able to designate non-banks, be they hedge funds or asset managers or something else, as systemically important, in order to bring more oversight /regulation by the Fed to these entities. Senator Warren asked Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen about this in a recent hearing, regarding the asset manager BlackRock. Here is a video clip of their exchange. One thing that's already happened, which I had previously called for, is that FSIC has now restarted its hedge fund working group. In terms of more steps, here's some more ideas.
Thanks for your time and response. I completely appreciate there are many other great questions on this sub and I wouldn't want to distract away from theirs. Extremely interested in hearing your thoughts on this topic. The everything short. BYU at aboot. The 4th of January 2021 edit, great news apes. You don't fight the volume has been reviewing my post and helping me address weaknesses. I take this as really good news as we move another step closer to exposing the truth. Furthermore, I am making updates that take speculative connections out of this post. The first one being the WSJ article covering BlackRock, where the Fed has tapped them to purchase bonds for the government. These bonds consist of mortgage-backed securities and corporate bonds, not treasuries. While this does not destroy the concept within the post, it does remove a link between the speculative relationship of BlackRock and Citadel. Citadel is still shorting bonds, other hedge funds are shorting bonds, BlackRock just isn't buying treasuries from the government. There are plenty of other financial institutions lending out the treasury bonds. We are still discussing the post and I will make updates as they are available. Stay tuned.
Two big picture thoughts. It is very difficult to truly understand what Citadel, the hedge fund, S complete positions are. That's due to a real lack of transparency in the reporting that hedge funds are required to do. Hedge funds managing $100 million or more of certain kinds of securities do have some reporting requirements. These happen quarterly through a form called the 13F. However, they only need to report certain kinds of securities. And they don't need to report short stock sales or short option positions. That makes it hard to know what a fund is doing, or what their net position is. I think more transparency into hedge fund positions would be good for the market overall. Here's a recent letter I helped to write on the topic. 2. I do think that regulators need to be closely monitoring the repo markets and seeing if there are places where reforms are needed. It has the potential to be a source of real risk to the financial system. If you'd like to read more about the repo markets, I suggest this piece from the Richmond Fed.
Not asking for financial advice, just for an assessment from an ape with a few more wrinkles. I wonder how likely it is that Morgan Stanley is also taking a big hit. Someone I know has put quite some money into one of their funds and I'd like to warn them before they lose all of it. People here keep talking mainly about Citadel, but who else is in this with them?
I actually wrote about this a little bit in my newsletter today. The short version is, we'll know more when Morgan Stanley's Q1 2021 earnings come out. But, the reporting around the Archegos fallout has indicated that Morgan Stanley and Goldman Sachs sold their Archegos-related stock first, ahead of other banks who also acted as a prime broker for Archegos. From the foot, it was like a game of chicken, one person said. By Friday morning, any hopes of coordination had been snuffed out and the floodgates opened when Goldman began pitching global investors on billions of dollars of Archegos-linked stocks. Morgan Stanley joined hours later, and the two sold roughly $19 billion in big block trades that day alone, according to the People.
Legendary Pokemon 29 minutes ago, hi Alexis, thanks for your time. Canadian here, how do you feel about this whole GME situation in terms of trust in the US markets? You've lost me as a customer, how many more? I've been trading for over a year now. I've been decimated before in pharma stocks by hedgies like Savvy Crappy Bastards and non-pharma by Hindenburg, where they've pushed the price into the ground for no reason besides greed. In total I've lost about 30k, then I came upon this gem that is GME and want to get my revenge on hedgies. In terms of Nasdaq, when Robinhood restricted buying and people were asking is this legal and such, the CEO of Nasdaq said they would have done the same to save the market. But rules should have been in place for hedgies to have never created such a bad situation in the first place. They only want to save the market now that we retailers are winning. I've seen thousands of people lose their jobs due to hedgies, Toys R Us to name one, and no one did anything then. After GME moons I am done with the US market. Sticking with TSX and OTC after this. The rampant market manipulation is out of control in the US. Excellent, gotcha, legendary Pokemon has been caught.
Can I ask you a question? Payment for order flow is prohibited in Canada. Curious if you have thoughts on if that's been a positive thing for market transparency and / or making clear the true cost of commissions for brokerages in Canada.
It's incredibly positive, seems to be much less shenanigans in the market and brokerages here. I've never had any issues with any of the ones I use. And it seems like the market makes its moves based on the demand rather than hedge funds manipulating it. But don't mind me, I am a very smooth-brained Canadian ape with only one wrinkle. So speaking only from buying a couple stocks on Wealth Simple, I have not felt like anything was hidden from me or I was paying anything I wasn't made evidently clear of. Am ape, zero financial knowledge. Edit, source, have been Canadian my whole life. In my opinion it is 100% better to have PFOF restricted. Why should a market maker be able to see where a retailer's ask, sell price is? As Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez said in the first hearing, the free cost of trades with Robinhood and others like Webull is not really free when it gives the market makers an edge. With this they can undercut you and place sells below your sell limit in large quantities to momentarily drop the price to trigger your stop loss. When in reality the cost of the share should be nowhere near this set price. It gives an edge to those with billions and again gives the finger to retailers. I personally pay for commissions with my bank, both during buy and sell, and they are their own clearinghouse so I know I'm safe. I also get instant deposits and transfers since it goes right to my bank account. What's your take on Senior DTC 2021-005? Any insight into when this might become effective? And, in general, do you think the flurry of newly proposed and implemented DTCC rule changes are related to the GME situation? Modify the DTC settlement service guide and the form of DTC pledges agreement, thanks. Edit URL for the docs and recent filings. In addition to this question, why should retail investors trust the DTCC to hold hedge funds accountable in the future? In our current situation, I understand that the new policies prevent them from footing the bill for defaulting hedge funds, but why should the DTCC be responsible for regulating naked shorting, especially when they have their own self-interests? Shouldn't regulating Wall Street be the responsibility of the SEC? Essentially, do you believe the new proposed policies, 801,804,805, would be giving the DTCC too much power as a private business, especially when they have their own interests that don't necessarily align with that of the average investor? DTCC policies 801, 804, 805.
While the DTCC is regulated, it is a systemically important financial market utility or SIFMU for short, see more here, it is not a regulator. It is up to all the financial regulators, together in their joint role as the Financial Stability Oversight Council, to ensure there aren't emerging risks to the financial system including looking at hedge funds. and the SEC has oversight into hedge funds through certain disclosures on the 13F, for example. I wrote about this a bit here. But, hedge funds do operate in a bit of a regulatory blind spot, because of their exemptions from the Investment Company Act of 1940. Congress could always change this to bring more scrutiny.
Hey Alexis, first of all I'd like to say it was great to see you raise actual issues during the congressional hearing. Having a voice like you speak in the name of fairer markets and the protection of the little fish retail investors is making me hopeful for the future. The questions I'd like to ask you would be, what kind of laws, regulations are you hoping will come out of the recent hearings and the current market activity? Do you think this will be to the benefit of retail investors? What are your thoughts on the current GameStop dollar GME volatility? Thanks for your time.
Some thoughts on this here. I also think Congress should consider changes to payment for order flow. They could do an outright prohibition, as exists in Canada and the UK, require brokers to pass any payment for order flow back to its customers. Require brokers allow customers to opt out. I wrote about this a bit in my written testimony at the hearing.
Hi Alexis, if we were to push for change for transparency in terms of disclosures by those operating in the blind spots, what would be the most effective play? Writing into SEC to file complaints or writing directly to Congress? On that note, do you feel that the SEC has insufficient powers to expand their regulatory supervision on these hedge funds operating in the blind spots and or creating rules for shorts reporting in addition to the bare-bones 13F filings, or is it a case where they have sufficient powers already, but are somehow choosing not to exercise their powers for whatever reason?
If you have to pick just one, I'd suggest writing to your senators and your congressperson. Calling the office is usually better than emailing, if you have the time. If you have time to do both, a great way to weigh in with the SEC is through submitting public comment to proposed regulations. This is what's called the notice and comment period. Here is a list of the current proposed rules at the SEC. I did this myself many years ago with a group of folks called Occupy the SEC. We wrote a comment letter about closing loopholes in the proposed Volcker rule, which was a ban on proprietary trading by the big banks. Here's an article about that if you want to learn more. The SEC should be able to change 13F requirements on its own. Here's a recent letter I helped to write on the topic.
Why do you think Robinhood pushes margin so hard on their users? It's pretty much impossible for a normal user to get out. Any of the following puts you in margin: fractional shares, instant settlement, Robinhood Gold. Unlike Fidelity, they do not disclose margin positions to their users in their UI. Need to check your monthly statement, which may even be out of date. Opting out of these features cannot be done with the UI. You need to contact their customer support. Also, even turning off margin doesn't convert your existing positions to cash. It seems like they push this extremely hard for some internal business purpose. Can you comment on what they might be doing behind the scenes?
My best guess is that they want to earn the interest that they charge on margin accounts. This is an interesting question for the regulators. Is Robinhood being clear about which accounts are margin or not?
So you think they're making money loaning out the users' shares to short sellers or other borrowers? Do you think this may be related to why the borrow fee for GME is abnormally low despite it being a hard-to-borrow security? Dumb question, but was Wall Street as cutthroat and cold as depicted in movies such as The Big Short or Margin Call?
The short answer is, it's not quite that dramatic. That said, the attitude is certainly cutthroat. People would talk about ripping their client's face off, which is what happens when you give your client a really bad deal and convince your client that it's a total bargain for them. The long answer is, here is a piece I wrote about my time on Wall Street. Here is a small snippet. On Wall Street, it is not frowned upon to rip the faces off one's own clients. If the client is dumb enough to get hoodwinked, that means the client didn't work hard enough. He didn't do his due diligence. In other words, if I screw you, you only have yourself to blame. That is the zero-sum game of trading. But perhaps the zenith of Wall Street fitness is the unpunished cheat. Around the holiday season, inter-dealer brokers will send gifts to the traders, trying to curry favor with bottles of wine or champagne. Inter-dealer brokers are brokers who allow Wall Street banks to anonymously trade with one another, since the last thing you want to do if you're Morgan Stanley is let Goldman Sachs know your position, though you may still want to trade with them. But there is a catch to the gift-giving. According to FINRA, Wall Street's self-regulatory agency, the brokers are only allowed to spend a maximum of $100 per trader. On slow winter days, the traders would Google the bottles of wine, trying to determine which vendors had cheated. Often they would find that, yes, this vendor breached the limit. The response to the cheat was always the same, a smirk and an approving nod. It's not about who cheated. It's about who cheated successfully.
So delicious. 30 minutes ago, thoughts on playing Among Us with AOC. Love your knowledge bombs dropped in that initial stream with her, and especially your insights during the first Congress hearing on GameStop. Thanks for taking your time with us all. Heart.
It was great to appear on Twitch with AOC once. I would be quite happy to play Among Us. I am a newbie at that game though, and thus, pretty bad at it.
Hi Alexis, and thank you for your time. I'm super late in my question, but how did you end up on GME in the first place? This place was created after WSB became compromised, and we've been called tinfoil hat conspiracists. Do you personally believe that the MOASS is still to come?
I tried to post in WSB and it was initially auto-flagged. They fixed it later. r/WallStreetBets posted by u/DontFightTheVol one day ago what happened with Archegos Capital. Dodging disclosures with total return swaps, prime brokers making bad choices, this post has been removed by the moderators of r/WallStreetBets. Moderators remove posts from feeds for a variety of reasons, including keeping communities safe, civil, and true to their purpose. In the meantime, some people suggested I post here instead. What happened with Archegos, total return swaps, 13F disclosures, prime brokers, and more discussion. Gorilla, there's a lot of moving parts in the story behind the Archegos meltdown, the market-wide sell-off, and the lack of disclosures that may have exacerbated the problem. I have found you all to be quite welcoming. I think GameStop volatility will continue because there are now just too many eyes on it, and too many people with FOMO. However, I don't think it's likely you'll see another giant short squeeze. That's what you mean by malaise, right? Because no one wants to get caught on the other end of that again. Option premiums on GameStop /GME implied volatility are still through the roof, too, and I presume will be for some time. Option sellers are going to demand a major premium for taking on risk of it going haywire again.
Okay, we have a problem. Why is there no unicorn award? Unicorn, 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 unicorn.
Maybe we should ask Steve Huffman.
Hey Alexis, thank you for coming. I'm curious, have you seen people get away with corruption in your early days? I'm really interested how big of a corruption problem you guys have there in the US. I cannot understand how it's possible to reset FTDs, how it's possible that people can short ladder attack and get away with it. Aren't they leaving a mark behind? Thank you once again for having us.
I'll leave it at what I've written previously, but perhaps the zenith of Wall Street fitness is the unpunished cheat. Around the holiday season, inter-dealer brokers will send gifts to the traders, trying to curry favor with bottles of wine or champagne. Inter-dealer brokers are brokers who allow Wall Street banks to anonymously trade with one another, since the last thing you want to do if you're Morgan Stanley is let Goldman Sachs know your position, though you may still want to trade with them. But there is a catch to the gift-giving. According to FINRA, Wall Street's self-regulatory agency, the brokers are only allowed to spend a maximum of $100 per trader. On slow winter days, the traders would Google the bottles of wine, trying to determine which vendors had cheated. Often they would find that, yes, this vendor breached the limit. The response to the cheat was always the same, a smirk and an approving nod. It's not about who cheated. It's about who cheated successfully. This attitude extends to higher stakes games as well. Take the case SEC v. Citigroup Global Markets, Incorporated. According to the SEC, in 2007 Citigroup sold their clients a portfolio of assets, mortgage-backed securities, as it happens, that Citi was actively betting against. The SEC therefore charged Citigroup with securities fraud. It's been reported that the fearsome regulatory agency won't settle for anything less than a $285 million fine. Looks bad, right? Well, yes, unless you consider that, according to Forbes, Citigroup allegedly made $160 million on this one deal. Investors lost $700 million. Citigroup looks like it's going to lose $125 million. But how many similar deals have gone UN prosecuted? If the answer is one, Citigroup is back in the black. If the answer is, as surely it must be, more than one, then Citigroup is doing very well, thank you. This is why paying fines when you are caught breaking the rules is simply deemed the cost of doing business on Wall Street. Poker is extremely popular across Wall Street, and provides an instructive lesson. The book Poker Winners Are Different by industrial psychologist and poker advisor Alan Schoonmaker presents a scenario where a player notices his best friend's tell, that is, the best friend has a habit of showing when he has a good or bad hand. The book then poses the following dilemma: should you, A. tell your friend, B. win a bit of money from him, and then tell him, or C. exploit your friend, never telling him? The correct answer, screw your friend. Schoonmaker, who used to do management development work at Merrill Lynch, writes that winners will do whatever the rules and ethics allow to maximize their profits. This behavior is heralded in poker and it's heralded on Wall Street. Despite what may be emblazoned on plaques or in mission statements, the ethics of Wall Street are purely about winning at any cost.
Have there been any other major financial events that have garnered you as much or greater attention as GME?
The 2008 financial crisis. I was working on Wall Street at the time. I wrote a bit about it here. And I also appear in the PBS Frontline documentary Money, Power, and Wall Street, Episode 4, and talk about it a bit there.
Hi Alexis, thank you so much for doing this. There was class action suit QS Holdco v Bank of America that was filed against BOA, GS and other Equilend Bank board members in 2017, alleging collusion, intimidation and other anti-competitive practices. The behavior was said to be designed to keep the stock lending market as opaque and profitable as possible, of which defendants controlled 70% of order flow. Are you aware of the case? What are your thoughts on the conduct alleged? Could the opacity created by Equilend have helped create or maintain the short squeeze situation on GameStop? What impact do you see the recent DTCC rule changes having on the current state of affairs for Equilend and the market as a whole?
Let me look more closely another time and I will circle back if I can.
A little late to the party, but I was wondering what you think we can do to better understand the systems at play and improve our situations. For example, I volunteer in LGBTQ and veteran policy advocacy, but want to get involved in financial reform because economic justice is social justice. My day job is as an HR professional at a corporate VC. We have apes from all different walks of life here. How can we educate ourselves and position ourselves to become better citizens? What can we do to help ensure this never happens again?
What a great question. And I agree with you that economic justice is social justice. As an aside, Representative Mundare Jones, for example, has recently highlighted why cancelling student debt is a LGBTQ issue in addition to a racial justice issue. A few ideas. The SEC Investor Bulletin's often a good source for information. If you are thinking beyond the realm of investing and into consumer finance broadly, I think the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, CFPB, is a great agency that puts out a lot of good reports, including on veterans, so may be of interest to you. And I hope people know that they can always complain to the CFPB if they have an issue with a consumer financial company. You can follow Real Bank Reform or Roosevelt Institute or Groundwork Collaborative or the Center for Equitable Growth on Twitter. I try to cover these issues at my newsletter, Markets Weekly, and over at my Twitter.
What are your ideal toppings on a baked potato?
I hope this doesn't get me booted from the UMA, but I don't really like baked potatoes.
Do you agree pineapple goes on pizza?
Yes.
Still stunned that pineapple on a pizza is okay with you, but here's a different and more important question. Tabasco, Tapatio, Cholula, Frank's, other hot sauce, or no hot sauce at all, ever. Also, thank you for taking the time to answer the more serious questions on here, Alexis.
I just like the pineapple.
Hi, Alexis. Thanks for taking the time. Do you really think we the people can have enough influence to have effective structure changes to the system?
I do. Especially right now, I think there's a big change to engage with Congress and the regulators to make some positive change. Here's some thoughts here.
Thank you, and no, pineapple doesn't go on pizza. Yes, but baked potatoes are too dry. I thought the baked potato thing was bad. I can't unsee it now.
Sorry to baked potatoes.
What is your favorite form of cooked potatoes? Fried, mashed, in a gratin, something else entirely?
I have to go with fried or gratin.
When you were working in Wall Street, what were some strategies you used that helped you survive the game? Did you have a poker face the whole time?
Taking time off when I could, which I'm afraid was rare, and having friends outside the industry to keep me grounded in reality.
That's awesome. Thank you for doing an armor with us. What are your thoughts on Congress passing a bill that implemented these stock market reforms? Feel free to ignore those you've already addressed in your other responses. Transaction fees, if there were a, say, 1% transaction fee on buying and selling a stock, this would limit the advantages that algorithms provide hedge funds. It would also discourage day trading. I believe you already mentioned this, but I wanted to know what you were thinking as far as the transaction fee. Stocks on blockchain require that all stocks use blockchain technology, so they can be tracked in real time. This would not only make for easier trading, it would also prevent trading in ghost shares and other hedge fund tactics. Prevent investment firms from selling investor trading information to hedge funds unless they provide the same information to the general public at the same time. By selling investor information, platforms like Robinhood essentially ensure that hedge funds will be able to identify market trends before retail investors. This eliminates all competitiveness in the market. Raise the amount SEC can fine companies to 10x the profit gained. As I understand it, the SEC can currently fine investors 3x what they gained for illegal practices, but to avoid lengthy court battles, they usually settle out of court for a smaller amount. By raising the limit to 10x the profit gained, it would give the SEC more leverage to avoid taking companies to court while at the same time discouraging illegal practices with higher punitive fees. The SEC would also make more money and therefore have more money available to pursue additional illegal practices. Stipulations preventing Treasury employees from working for private financial institutions for a period of 2 years after they hold their Treasury positions.
No one is suggesting a financial transaction tax that high, 1%. The proposals are more in the realm of 0.1% or so. I think adding a very small transaction tax would reduce the power of high-frequency traders like Citadel or Renaissance Technology, and this could lead to less volatility in the market overall. Proposals like the Wall Street Tax Act or the Inclusive Prosperity Act would put in place a Wall Street sales tax at rates of a fraction of a percent, at most 50 cents per $100 of stocks traded. The government estimates that would raise more than $750 billion over 10 years. Wall Street tends to push back very hard when people suggest a financial transaction tax, but this ignores that fact that the sex operations are already funded in part by a very small fee on certain transactions. The UK has a stamp tax and their market didn't melt down. The UK imposes two stamp duty taxes that impact financial transactions. The first is stamp duty, which applies to instruments that transfer certificated shares, i.e., shares that are traded off exchange through physical transfer, at a rate of 0.5%. The transfer is generally processed with a stock transfer form.
Is it reasonable to start with giving retail a fair chance in the market before we start cancelling student debt, increasing taxes, etc.?
We can walk and chew gum. Cancelling student debt is a question the president / the Department of Education can do without Congress. Making sure the markets are working for retail investors is a question for the SEC, CFTC, the Financial Stability Oversight Council, and some of the macroprudential regulators.
Hi, Alexis. Thank you for being a part of this community. Having individuals with experience, credentials, and expertise really expands this place from a subreddit to a powerful community with real-world impact. My Q, what are some basic actions everyday people, Redditors, can take to get the attention of those with power to challenge, regulate the rampant criminal and illegal activity in the stock market? As an everyday person, it is extremely demoralizing and infuriating at times to witness the corruption, know that the government and SEC know about it, yet still see very little being done. As an average investor in GME, it's essentially impossible to feel at this time that the market is fair. Yet, as Americans, we've been told this amazing lie that we have an innate right and privilege as citizens to participate in free and fair markets and in the greatest economy in the world. Wow, what a load of crap. This time, people won't be fooled. Either this actually becomes the case or people will pull their dollar in order to simply stop dealing with the absolute crookery and knob-stroking that our financial system permits. It's really quite disgusting. As this journey has continued, the information regarding naked short-selling, hiding FTDS, etc. has been becoming clearer and clearer week after week. There is no question that blatant market manipulation is happening. Right now, it feels like Reddit has more real-world impact than the government, the SEC, and all regulatory bodies, and that is very troubling. Q2, on a more philosophical note, I want to ask that in your opinion, based on your work experience and what you see with Wall Street, do you think there is even a possibility at this point in time for Wall Street to even remotely tame its hyper-predatory and bloodthirsty tactics? I mean, is any kind of fundamental shift in the makeup and psyche of these institutions possible? As a depth psychologist, I think Wall Street traders represent probably one of the most fascinating, important, and horrifying case studies of the modern world. The psychology present is not to look over. One of the most distinct characteristics is a lack of empathy. Enacted at the level it has been, the results are truly horrific. 08 was just a glimpse of what this kind of unchecked behavior leads to. One thing I know about addiction is this: there is a very common fallacy to think that once you get it out of your system, you'll be good. Any addict know that is BS, and rather what happens is it gets worse. Your tolerance goes up, not down, and now the only thing that will make you feel better is something even more intense. What I really see in our financial industry and in the markets is a stark reality: brilliant minds and industries throttled by the disease of addiction in various forms. Greed, power, wealth, ego, being right, drugs, sex, fame, etc. The fact that these are largely the people who make major decisions for the population, whether aware of it or not. is a really difficult pill to swallow, but one we need to as a society if we are to move forward. I think this discussion needs to be had and fleshed out. Until the people realize what is happening there, I doubt there will be change.
Q1. Weigh in with the SEC on their proposed rules. Contact your senators and representative and let them know what reforms you are hoping to see. More on this here.
Not sure if the armor is still on. I am reposting. Hello, Alexis. Thank you for your work and insights. Your comments in recent weeks have been the smartest I have seen in the media. I have two questions. Is the DTCC actually moving this fast in response to the GME saga? If you were in the shoes of the hedge funds, what would you do to get out of the mess? Trying to understand what could they do to scuttle the long positions.
I mean, hedge funds have a lot of different strategies, and many of them may be long GME at this point, at least in the short term. This has always been my general thesis, that GME may have been ignited by retail, but there are likely big institutional players involved as well. I spoke about this a bit on the BBC, and at my newsletter.
Do you have any stories for us from your career? 3 days no market make apes dull apes.
One time one of the traders bet someone in operations if they would drink the grease at the bottom of a tray of chicken wings. He did. He lived, if you were wondering.
Is Gary Gensler going to do anything to help retail or at least push for more regulation?
Gensler was a very strong advocate for investors when he ran the CFTC, so his nomination is promising.
You, don't fight the volume. Answering this question requires speculation. If you're not here for speculation, I totally get it. How do you see this whole scenario playing out? We obviously have massive money on both sides of this play. You've got retail in the middle, and we've got the bottomless bit of short positions. You stated earlier that the MOASS is essentially off the table, so how do you think this ends?
My best bet is that I think GME will continue to be like a rollercoaster, lots of volatility. I genuinely don't know how it ends.
Hello, Alexis. Thank you for doing this. You mentioned you're a programmer. Out of curiosity, what does the tech stack look like? If one wanted to get into fintech, what languages should they focus on, and how does one pivot into fintech from regular tech?
I think which language you choose matters less than finding one you like and getting some practice in it. Once you learn one language, it's easier to learn another one. If you like investing, I do think Python is particularly handy, since there are a lot of tools for scraping data.
Posting again, as I think my question has fallen into the abyss. Hi, Alexis. Thank you so much for this. I suspect that retail has been buying synthetic shares and probably holds a very large quantity of them. I am concerned that the shares that I own are not real shares. Is there anything I can do to make sure that I have real shares as opposed to synthetic? What would happen if real shares would need to be located in a situation where I decided to hold the shares in my own name by transferring them to a transfer agent? Would real shares be allocated to me then? How can they locate the real shares?
Do you mean using option positions to go synthetically long? Like a very deep ITM call?
What I mean is that it seems like short sellers have oversold GME. There are more shares owned by participants than there should be in existence. This makes me think that retail traders have been buying synthetic shares. Which leads me to fear that I don't currently own the actual shares.
I'm just still not sure what you mean by synthetic shares. The main way I know to go synthetically long a stock is with options.
Hi, Alexis, not going to give you a super interesting question or anything, but are you doing okay? Emotionally, mentally. Things aren't easy right now, so take this question as a drink some water, check your posture, look at a cute cat video, moment winking face.
This is a very nice question and I appreciate it. It's been a little hard because I recently lost my amazing cat Tito. I appreciate you reminding me to drink water and asking a thoughtful question. I hope you are also taking it easy right now, too.
Thank you so much for being here, Mrs. Goldstein. I want to relax the atmosphere a little by asking you some gaming-related questions, and I'll be so honored if you could answer. What's your favorite video game, S? Which one marked you forever? Thanks in advance for everything.
Final Fantasy VII is legendary. I binge-played it till I finished it. I recently played the remake and really enjoyed that, too. Have you heard about the book Luster by Raven Leilani? She said, I learned about storytelling from Final Fantasy.
What does your username mean? Volume as in volatility. Then again, I shouldn't be the one to dive in usernames, lol.
Yes, Vol as in volatility.
Who's Sevil and why shouldn't I fight him?
Vol equals volatility and fighting against volatility can get you run over.
You mentioned that you don't believe MOASS is likely given what happened in January and no one wants to be caught on the wrong end again. Is that assuming that the shorts have covered the positions? Thanks for doing this.
I want to stress that I don't have a crystal ball. I just think enough shorts got burned that people are probably more cautious now than they were before. And anyone selling options on GME are demanding very high premiums for taking the risk. You can see this in the implied volatility levels on GME options. But anything can happen, of course. Past performance is no guarantee of future results, etc. etc.
Doesn't that correlate better with the likelihood of a gamma squeeze rather than a short squeeze? Hi, Alexis, thank you for all of your time. Not sure if this has been asked, but what are a few of your favorite books? Thanks.
Thank you so much for asking me. If the question is about options, I am the very best book on options trading is the one by Sheldon Natenberg. It's called Option Volatility and Pricing, Advanced Trading Strategies and Techniques, the second edition, or you can get the first edition, still great, but it's cheaper. It's very dense, but it's so informative. If you really want to understand options, I'd start here. If you're asking about all books, I love Thick by Tressie McMillan Cottom, non-fiction, Patsy by Nicole Dennis Benn, fiction, and the book M-Train, which I think of as a love letter to coffee.
I always wondered if it would be hard being in a position of power where you see both hundreds of millions as a small cost of doing business, as well as people in the country dying because they're rationing insulin. What is the general feeling among the circles you run in about the crushing levels of poverty in the same country where billions are made?
In my circles, the general sense is that we need our government to do a lot more to get relief out and unrig the rules so they work for everyone, not just the well-connected. That's gonna take a lot of people pushing for it together, but it's possible.
Hi, do you have any comments on the Archegos capital situation?
I do. I wrote a post about it here. What happened with Archegos Capital? Last week, Viacom CBS lost half its value. But Viacom's woes turned into a $33 billion fire sale thanks to Archegos Capital, total return swaps, and leverage. I gotta run, thanks everyone for the discussion today. I just like the pineapple.
Unicorn, 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 unicorn. I just like the pineapple.